Hello friends, I welcome you all to StudyIQ, India's largest e-learning platform. My name is Dr. Mahipal Singh Rathod, and in this video, I will be discussing the history of the Battle of Saraighat and its hero Lachit Borphukan. In India, most of us have heard about Rana Pratap, Chhatrapati Shivaji and their valor and bravery. But most of us have not heard about Lachit Borphukan, the Ahom Kingdom and the Battle of Saraighat. With this video, StudyIQ wants to tell the tale of this brave son of India to everyone. So with that, I request you to share this video as much as possible so that each and every person knows about this brave son of India. Before beginning the story of Saraighat, I want to tell you that StudyIQ has launched its pen drive and tablet courses for all kinds of competitive exams for government jobs like SSC, CGL, CHSL, bank examinations, UPSC Civil Services. All these courses are available on our website studyiq.com. You can sit and prepare from your home. You do not need to go anywhere to any of the metropolitan cities to prepare for competitive examinations. We also have a test series so that you can test your preparation sitting at home. For more details, contact on these numbers or visit our website. You'll get all the details over there. The Battle of Saraighat was fought in 1671, 17th century, 1671 AD or CE. As you like, you can put write whatever you want. It was fought between the Mughal Empire on one side and the Ahom Kingdom on the other. You might know about the Mughal Empire, and those of you who do not know about the Ahom Kingdom, the next slide will be for you. The battle was fought on the Brahmaputra River. It was a combined battle, a naval battle, as well as a battle on land, a traditional battle, at a place called Saraighat, which is part of Guwahati city today. So right on the banks of Brahmaputra as well as on the river on boats. Now, what are the different things you will learn in this video lecture? First, who were the Ahoms? A brief history about Ahom Kingdom. Why were Mughals and Ahom had a conflict? Who was Lachit Borphukan? The decisive battle of Saraighat and the aftermath of this battle. The Ahom Kingdom was established in the year 1228 in the 13th century, and it lasted till the 19th century in 1826 when the East India Company annexed it. Almost 600 years, a very long time period, and the territory extended over what is present day the state of Assam. The dynasty was established by Sukhfa. So he was a prince from an area of Myanmar called Shan. The Shan state is situated towards the east of Myanmar, east of Burma. So it is not towards India border, it is towards China and the border of China and northern Thailand. Towards that side is situated Shan, and he was a prince from there. He came to India after crossing Patkai Mountains, and he established his kingdom here in Assam. This was the royal insignia of this dynasty. And just to clarify a little bit more, you can see the geographically the location of the Patkai Bum Mountains, the Naga Hills and the Mizo Hills. Here are the Garo, Khasi, Jayantia, very important for geography. The sequence of these mountains is pretty important. So he crossed the mountains, came over from Myanmar and established his rule here in the valley of the Brahmaputra River. This was the Ahom Kingdom at its maximum extent in the final years, 19th century. You can see it extended almost from Sadia till here where the Manas River meets the Brahmaputra River. So this was the boundary. Historically, traditionally, this Manas River was the western boundary of Ahom Kingdom. After this, where the kingdoms of Kuch Bihar and others, I'll tell you in later in the subsequent slides. And here it was almost entire valley of the river Brahmaputra, the plain area of Assam, the plains area of Assam. Capital was around this area. So Gargaon, Jorhat, Sibsagar, the capitals kept changing. There were 2-3 capitals. Most of the time it was Gargaon. In the chronicles of the medieval historians, the kings of this Ahom dynasty are called Assam Raja, simply denoting that they rule over Assam. The people of that kingdom, on the other hand, called them Chaufa. Chaufa means, Chau is ruler and Fa is heaven. So it means they are the rulers of the heaven. It means Assam is called as heaven, and the rulers, they are the rulers of the heaven. Or in Hindi, they will be called Swargdev. So this is the equivalent in Assamese from the 16th century. The Ahom kings let themselves be influenced by the religion and customs of those they ruled over. See, these people came from Myanmar or Burma. So they were not having the same culture, language, ethnicity of the people of India or Assam in 12th century AD, 13th century AD. But when they came and they ruled over here, They did not come in lakhs or crores. Only few people came and established the kingdom. But since they were ruling over a population which was predominantly Hindu, so those Hindu customs were seen in the customs and traditions of the royal family soon enough, and Hindu influence was there everywhere. Even the lineage of the kings was traced to God Indra. So God Indra was considered to be the god from whom the Assam kings, the Ahom kings, have descended. So this shows that they were intricately linked to the religion of the people over whom they ruled. Even today in Assam, you cannot say that everyone is the descendant of Ahoms. In the last census in which this ethnicity was asked in 1901 during the British time, around 10% of the people in Assam established themselves, they declared themselves to be of Ahom descent. And even today it is estimated that around 20 to 25% population of Assam is of Ahom descent. The Ahom kings had a council of ministers. There were five main ministers. They were the Burhagohai, Borgohai, Borpatrogohai, Borbarua, and Borphukan. I have kept these names here only for you to understand that Borphukan was one of the most important ministers. He was the leader of the military. And Lachit Borphukan, as you can now understand by the name, Borphukan was his title. It was the position he held, and Lachit was his name. So how did this 600-year-old kingdom end? Because of the war between Burma and East India Company. This is the short answers. But before that, the Burmese kingdoms, the North Burmese kingdoms, they attacked Assam. They were neighbors. So Burmese invasions of Assam between 1817 and 1826 devastated the kingdom, and it came under Burmese rule from 1821. So Ahom kings were merely puppets of Burma during this time for 4 years. They were under the rule of Burma. In 1825, the Burmese people had a fight with East India Company. And this war, the first Anglo-Burmese war in 1824 to 1826, it ended with the Treaty of Yandabo. East India Company's armies reached near the capital of Burma, Ewa, and this place near the capital, Yandabo, this is where the treaty was signed in 1826, in which Burma gave away the territory of Assam or Ahoms to East India Company. East India Company was very smart. They wanted control over the fertile Brahmaputra Valley, from where the waters was coming down to the Bangladesh region, the Bengal province of that time. They already had control over Bengal since a long time. Now they wanted control over the upper Brahmaputra Valley, so they had control over Ahoms now. In this manner, between the fight of Burmese and East India Company, Ahom was annexed by the East India Company, and since then it was a part of the British territories. Coming back to the 16th and 17th century, this is the time period that we are dealing with now for the Battle of Saraighat. So this blue colored area was Ahom territory. Then there is the Jayantia Kingdom to the south here in Meghalaya. There is the Kachar Kingdom here, Manipur, and most importantly the Kuch Bihar Kingdom here. So they are the immediate western neighbors of Ahoms. Ahoms and Kuch Bihar had a love-hate relationship. Sometimes they were good friends, most of the times they were fighting as they are neighbors. But this Mughal Empire had started spreading from the areas of Lahore, Delhi, and gradually during the time of Akbar, it had control over Bengal. So Akbar had expanded Mughal Empire a lot, and he had control over Bengal. And during Akbar's time only, they started efforts to take control of this Ahom and Kuch Bihar and other kingdoms as well. But they were not successful. Their fights started in the 17th century during the time of Jahangir, and it continued till the time of Aurangzeb. Just remember in this map, what is Ahom, where is Ahom, and where is Kuch Bihar. Later on, this Kuch Bihar, around the time of 1600 only, this Kuch Bihar kingdom was split into two, western and eastern. Because of fighting in the family of the royal family, the king split the kingdom in two halves to give to his two sons. And the precipitating cause for the fight between Mughals and Ahom was that one side supported this half, this faction of the royal family in Kuch Bihar, and the Mughals supported the other half. So the relationship between Ahoms and the Mughals was hostile due to certain factors. First was the Mughal alliance with Kuch Bihar, which was the western enemy of the Ahoms. Then there was the growing advance of the Mughals in the northeastern frontier, which alarmed them. Mughal expansionist policy to annex the fertile valley of Brahmaputra. Mughal Empire, since its beginning, was an expansionist kingdom. All the kingdoms are expansionist. Whenever you see them in ancient, medieval, or even modern India, you see most of the kingdoms, they tried to expand. The East India Company tried to expand. But Mughal Empire was particularly successful at it, mainly due to the military tactics and genius of Akbar. and it expanded at a rapid pace. So Mughals wanted to expand in this region as well. Finally, trade and boundary disputes, as they were neighbors. There were some disputes regarding trade, who could trade in Ahom traders could not trade in Bengal, and these small disturbances finally led to a war between them in 1615. From 1615 to 1682, the Mughals and the Ahoms fought multiple times. There were 18 major campaigns or battles along with many smaller skirmishes. The final precipitating factor here in 1615 was a dynastic dispute in the Cooch Behar kingdom. It led to the initial conflict. The Ahoms and the Mughals intervened by supporting the contesting factions. It was already bifurcated into western and eastern Cooch Behar, and then again there were these two sides, the big empires, the big neighbors, they were supporting opposing factions. Ahoms held on to their territories in the end by pushing back Mughals in 1682. Sometimes the Ahoms were successful, sometimes the Mughals were successful. Guwahati changed hands many a times, but finally the Ahoms held on to their territories by 1682, and after that Aurangzeb never had a campaign here because he got busy with the Marathas and Deccan. Now we will talk about Lachit Borphukan. This is a statue of Lachit, the great military general. This statue stands in the middle of the Brahmaputra River in Guwahati, and here Lachit can be seen leading his men into the battle. Lachit Borphukan was born in 1622 to Mumai Tamuli. His father was a Bor Barua or a governor. He was a senior administrator in the Ahom kingdom. Lachit was educated in humanities, military tactics, and holy scriptures. He held on to various important appointments before being appointed as the Ahom army general. So he was also the personal secretary of the king at one point of time. That is considered to be a very important position. And later on, he was made the Ahom army general. He strengthened the Ahom army greatly. Actually, he was made the army general after the Ahoms were defeated very badly around 1662. They had a very big defeat from the Mughal army. After that, he was made the general, and he strengthened the Ahom army for the future. He was an ardent patriot, a clever diplomat, a great military leader. He used all his skills during the Battle of Saraighat. I will tell you how he used diplomacy as well as military tactics to win a battle against a larger opposition. He had unusual grit, willpower, stamina, and depth of judgment. When he was the army general, he recaptured Guwahati from Mughals in 1667, and he defended it again in 1671 at the Battle of Saraighat. So these were the two highlights of his career as a military general. He was the commander-in-chief of the Battle of Saraighat. The king presented Lachit with a gold hafted sword, which is called a hangdang, to carry out the task of defeating the Mughals. So this was before Saraighat, this was before the campaign in 1669. He was given this gold hafted sword. 24th November, that is the birthday of Lachit, is celebrated by the people in Assam as Lachit Divas, where they commemorate the heroism of Lachit Borphukan. Now there are two famous instances from his life. They are anecdotes from his life. Both are from or before the Battle of Saraighat. So before the battle, Lachit Borphukan had instructed his army to make a lot of defensive walls to protect against the oncoming army and all these cities along the Brahmaputra River. He ordered them to fortify them with earthen walls. So his uncle, who was also a military officer, was entrusted with the task of building one of these walls. But his uncle took the job very lightly. He did not complete it on time. So when Lachit came for an inspection, he saw that his uncle's lack of effort had led to the wall being not completed. He chopped off his uncle's head right at that moment, saying that an uncle is not as important as the country. My relatives are not as important as the country and its defenses. This sent down shivers among the army men, among the soldiers, but they were now alert. They were on their feet and they realized the gravity of the situation. The second one is from the battlefield in the Battle of Saraighat itself, when Lachit Borphukan told his fleeing soldiers, they were losing the battle, the Ahoms were losing the battle and the soldiers were running back. He told his soldiers, if you want to flee, then you flee. The king has given me a task here and I will do it well. Let the Mughals take me away. Even if they kill me, it doesn't matter. You report to the king that his general fought well following his orders. And this brought the morale of the troops back again, and his troops started fighting and it turned the tide of the battle. Now coming to the actual battle itself, the Battle of Saraighat. As I told you about an earlier campaign where the Ahoms were defeated badly, that was in 1661 to 63. See, sometimes the Ahoms were victorious, sometimes the Mughals were victorious. But in this particular campaign, in 1661 to 63, the Ahoms suffered a crushing defeat because for the first time, their capital was also defeated. The Mughal army reached up to the capital and there the king had to sign a humiliating treaty in which he had to give away a lot of gold to the Mughals, as well as he has to give away Kamrup and Guwahati. So the area surrounding Guwahati is called Kamrup, historical region of Kamrup. There is a Kamrup district even today. So those areas went to the Mughals. But in 1667, Lachit Borphukan, who was the military leader by this time, he recaptured Guwahati in a brave attack. On receiving word of the defeat or recapture of Guwahati, Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb deputed his powerful Rajput king and general Mirza Raja Ram Singh of Amer. Amer is near Jaipur. So at that time there was no Jaipur city. There was the capital was Amer. So Raja Ram Singh was given an army. He was given the command of an army and he was asked to attack the Ahoms. So Raja Ram Singh left Delhi in 1667. It took him more than a year to reach Ahom, the territory of Ahom via Bengal. So the final campaign started around 1660. Early 1669, late 1668. Chakradwaj Singha was the Ahom king at that time and the commander of the army was Lachit. So Lachit Borphukan. To stall this stronger and numerically superior Mughal army led by Mirza Raja Ram Singh, Lachit Borphukan sent word for negotiations. So he used his diplomatic skills. He said that I want to speak to the invading army. Let us talk, let us negotiate, not fight a war. But he had no intentions of negotiating. Actually, he sent for negotiations just to get more time because the defenses of the cities were not complete. He wanted to build the proper defenses of the capital as well as many other places. And by the time the talks were going on, the negotiations were going on, he got time to strengthen his defenses. And finally, he sent a letter one day that I have been given the duty by God to protect my motherland and I am not going to give it away to you, to the Mughals. So the battles started, there were small battles, multiple battles and skirmishes throughout 1669 and 70. Sometimes the Ahoms were victorious, sometimes the Mughals were victorious. Since the Ahom army was smaller in numbers, they used guerrilla tactics in the mountains and to harass the Mughal armies. The Mughal commander Raja Ram Singh got so annoyed with the skirmishes, the guerrilla tactics, that he gave an open challenge to the Ahom king Chakradwaj Singha that if you have guts, come fight us out in the open. The Ahoms took up the challenge and they came out in the open and then there was a major battle. But at this battle, the Ahoms were defeated badly. This was the battle at Alaboy and in 1669, they lost around 10,000 soldiers here, which was a huge number for the Ahoms. So after this defeat at Alaboy, the Ahoms again started to use guerrilla tactics. And this time when the war was taking a critical turn, the king Chakradwaj Singha, he died. And his brother Udaditya Singha became the new ruler. By 1671, early 1671, a final battle was going to take place and the Ahoms decided to fight it out at Guwahati. The reason Guwahati was chosen by the army commanders and Lachit Borphukan was that it was a hilly area south of Brahmaputra. There are a lot of hills where Guwahati is situated. And it is on the way to the heart of the Ahom kingdom. You cannot go to the core areas of the Ahom territory or to the capital without crossing Guwahati. So there are hills which can act as a natural defense, natural barrier, and there is the river. So this river and hills restricted the mobility of the large Mughal army. The river is also not very wide here. Usually Brahmaputra is almost 7, 8, 10 kilometers, 15 kilometers wide at many places. But here at Saraighat in Guwahati city, it is narrowest at 1 kilometer width, which is optimum for a naval defense. And the Mughals did not have a very powerful navy. So they would be forced to use this navy. And Ahoms, since this was their home territory, they knew naval warfare very well. So they wanted to use this to their advantage. Have a look at this map here. So in this satellite view, you can clearly see that this is the Brahmaputra River. It is so wide that you can see it from the space. It is such a wide river. So this was the core area, Jorhat. Here was the capital and they wanted to take the last stand here at Guwahati. Why? See, the river is so wide here, but when you see it near Guwahati, firstly, there are hills here. See, this is all hilly areas And at Guwahati, it is a very narrow stretch of the river. So this is Guwahati city. This is only 1 kilometer wide. And this bridge that you see across the river is called Saraighat Bridge. So Saraighat was here on the northern banks, and the other part of the city was here on the southern banks. So this is where the battle was fought. This is the place where the battle was fought in Guwahati. To check the Mughal advance, Lachit prepared a complex system of mud embankments in Guwahati. When the Mughals found the Guwahati city impregnable by land, they would be forced to use their navy, which was their weakest asset. But just before the battle, Aurangzeb sent his own uncle, Shaista Khan, with more armies, more naval ships along to assist Raja Ram Singh's army. So now the Mughal army was more powerful, it had more ships. So this was just before the Battle of Saraighat. This is a representative map of the battle. So this is Guwahati city. The Mughals attacked from here, the northern side, and this is where the naval battle took place in the dotted blue lines. Homes defended from here in Itakhuli. There's the fort of Itakhuli and along the southern banks. So they wanted to strengthen this part so that Mughals cannot land here on the south southern banks of the city. This is where the battle was fought. Unfortunately, at the time of the battle, Lachit fell very ill, and the doctors advised him not to go out in the battlefield. He was advised not even to stand. He was advised to get bed rest. He was so ill. But when the battle started, the Ahoms were on the back foot. The soldiers started retreating. All the Ahom soldiers, they were retreating from the battlefield. When Lachit saw this, he stood up from his tent. He came out. He called for 6 or 7 boats, mounted on the boat himself. And then he spoke those famous words that if you want to flee, flee, but I have been given a duty by my king and I will do it even if I die trying. Go and tell the king that I did my duty perfectly, I did it well. So seeing his enthusiasm, his soldiers rallied to him, and this statue on the Brahmaputra in Guwahati depicts exactly that moment when he asked his soldiers to charge back into the battle. So he set sail on the river in few boats, and seeing him, their own general, going on to the fight, the soldiers also rallied behind him. The entry of Borphukan transformed the Ahom soldiers. His small flotilla of 6 to 7 boats swelled with other Ahom warships, and they smashed into the Mughal warships on the river. The river was filled with men and boat. The Ahoms spanned the river over an improvised bridge of boats and resorted to a combined front and rear attack. So they joined all their boats together and formed a bridge which led them to the northern banks, and now they started attacking the Mughals camp on the northern side, the Mughals on the land as well as on the river. The Mughal admiral Munawar Khan was killed by a gunshot, thus throwing the Mughals defenses out of gear. They also suffered the loss of 3 top ranking Amirs. Amirs are senior leaders or senior generals. Another 4,000 soldiers were dead. 4,000 Mughal soldiers died in this battle. The day of this decisive battle is not known for certain, only that it happened sometime in the middle of March 1671. What was the aftermath of the battle? Firstly, the Mughals were pursued to the Manas River, which was the traditional border, Manas River on the western border of Ahom Kingdom, but they did not pursue them behind Manas. They did not want any more trouble with the Mughal armies beyond or even the Koch Bihar Kingdom. So this, they chased it till the border, Ahom Kingdom's western boundary. Raja Ram Singh was there for a couple of months. He was there till April. He tried to attack again. He was waiting, but he could not get the chance to attack again. So he left Kamrup in April 1671 with his army, and he went back to Bengal. Lachit Borphukan died at Kaliabor about a year later in April 1672. Also, this was not the final battle between the Ahoms and the Mughals, although this was a very decisive one and one that goes down in the history books, mainly because of the large Mughal armies and the smaller Ahom forces which successfully defeated them. Lachit Borphukan's own brother and successor, Laluk Sola, deserted Guwahati for the Mughals in 1679. So again, after 8 years, the Mughals got control of Guwahati. But this was not for long time, as in 1682, there was another battle. It is called the Battle of Itakhuli. This is also in Guwahati only. There was a fort at Itakhuli. So there was the Battle of Itakhuli in 1682, and Ahoms again defeated Mughals, and they got control in Kamrup forever. The Mughals did not try to attack the Guwahati area or the Ahoms again. And Aurangzeb also got busy after 1681 with the Marathas, so he did not have the resources or the time to devote to Ahoms. So thus, Ahoms were one of the few kingdoms that were attacked by Mughals for many years, but still they held on. Most of the other kingdoms of Northern India, Central India, and even Deccan fell to the Mughal power. Mughals, and they accepted Mughal suzerainty if they did not vanish completely. Just the Marathas, they held out, but even the Maratha territories were under Mughal control for a long time. It can be said that Ahoms were very successful against the Mughals overall because they held on to their territories forever, at least till the East India Company arrived. In memory of Lachit Borphukan and to commemorate his valor, his bravery, his quick thinking on the battlefield, the best passing out cadet of National Defense Academy is conferred with the Lachit Borphukan Gold Medal every year. The army wants its future officers to be just as brave, show just as much valor, and have that ability to lift the morale of troops when required on the battlefield to be like Lachit Borphukan in future, and that is why this medal is named after him. I hope you liked this video, and I would request you to share this as much as possible. Also, you can give me feedback in the comment section and you can suggest topics on which you want me to make more videos like this or any other topic. Thank you very much and have a good day.